Now, I think today our topic is spiritual blindness, the enemy within. Spiritual blindness, the enemy within. We're at a time in the world all over where so many things outside are asking for people's attention. And people are worried about enemies from outside. So in other parts of the world, people are trying to make sure that they are not swamped by illegal immigrants. And there are all sorts of stories about how that is playing out in different parts of the world. I just read a news headline yesterday that Nigerians with unofficial documents in the U.S. to get ready because Trump is going to send them back home. So nowadays, there is a lot of fear about the stranger, the person who is different from us. And in the book of Isaiah, at this time in Israel's history, especially the southern kingdom, Judah, they were also facing a lot of external threats. There were two world powers, one established, one that was freshly rising at that time, Babylon and Assyria, who were a huge threat to Israel. And they saw their neighbors, like Damascus, Aram, were conniving with some of those more distant world powers to impose domination over Israel. So as people looked, they were worried. And you know, a lot of times, you need to be careful when you're in the capital city, right? When you're in Abuja, you enjoy Abuja. But when there is trouble, you also suffer the trouble of Abuja. For example, in Nigeria, we know that the Shiites have been marching on Abuja. So people have been complaining that their lives have been ended these past few days and weeks. Because suddenly, something that is not their business, isn't it? Their leader was arrested. He said he got a court order to be released, and the president will not release him. So they are marching, but then ordinary people are affected. If the president is going to the airport, he will go to the airport, isn't it? It doesn't stop him from moving from his house to the office. But it is the ordinary people that are affected. And so that is the reality of living in capital city. Jerusalem was like that. As the people were looking out, they were really worried. If you lived in Jerusalem at that time, you saw the external threats. But this passage we're about to go through today hints at something beyond the external threats that people are used to looking at. God, through the prophet Isaiah, is speaking to Jerusalem about something that was closer to spiritual blindness, the enemy. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this morning. Please speak through me. Speak to each person's heart here in a way that the heart will respond. Make our hearts of flesh to respond to your word. Make our hearts fertile soil that we live fruit in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, we are starting this as the background of the Equa theme, which is behold and bring a new thing. And I said in the first time that everybody likes new things. So if you get a new clothes, you want to wear it immediately. You have a new car, you want to drive it. Who do you want to buy it for? Anything. We love new things. Our theme for this church, from the same Isaiah 43:19, is families in God's new plan. But today's passage says if we want to look at the new things, we need to deal with some old problems. We need to deal with some old problems before we can be beneficiaries of these new things. Now, this section of Isaiah 28-35, almost the last part of the Old Testament Isaiah, because from Isaiah 40, we suddenly have a different section of Isaiah, was written about 20 years into Isaiah's ministry and consists of six woes. Six woes. So it's almost a section about woes. Woe to this, woe to that. We had one, I believe, last Sunday on the Northern Kingdom, Ephraim, as we talked about pride and the problems in Ephraim, the Northern Kingdom. But this passage we are looking at is the second woe from this section. Surprisingly, this woe is not against Babylon or Assyria or Damascus, but is against Judah. It's against Jerusalem. And we'll see just a few points how God dealt with the problem that led to this war and why it's such an important thing, and draw some lessons for today. So this second war is a condemnation on Ariel, the city of David. Now at this point, you must understand that Isaiah knew that all he was preaching, Israel was not going to pay attention to. The nation of Judah were set in their ways. And in 28 verse 14 to 22, he gave very specific instructions, very specific statements from God on what Israel ought to do to survive all the threats he was seeing. And most of them had to do with dealing with crime. But he knew that it would be to no avail. In fact, all the things they were doing, especially the leadership, were opposite to what God said. And we'll see how this plays out. So let's read Isaiah chapter 29, verse 1 to 14. I'm reading from NASB. Woe, O Ariel, Ariel, the city where David once camped. Add year to year, observe your feasts on Shebel. I'll bring distress to Ariel, and she will be a city of lamenting and mourning, and she will be like an Ariel to me. I will come against you and settle in you, and I will set siege works against you. And I will raise up battle towers against you. Then you will be brought low. From the earth you will speak, and from the dust where you are prostrate, your words will come. Your voice will also be like that of a spirit from the ground, and your speech will whisper from the dust. But the multitude of your enemies will become like fine dust, and the multitude of the ruthless ones like the chaff which blows away. And it will happen instantly, suddenly. From the Lord of hosts will be punished with thunder and earthquake and loud noise, with whirlwind and tempest, and the flame of the consuming fire. And the multitude of all the nations who wage war against Israel, even all who wage war against her and her stronghold, and who distress her, will be like a dream, a vision of the night. It will be as when a hungry man dreams, and behold, he is eating. But when he awakens, his hunger is not satisfied. Or as when a thirsty man dreams, and behold, he is drinking. But when he awakens, behold, he is famished, and his thirst is not quenched. Thus, the multitude of all the nations will be who wage war against Mount Zion. Be delayed and wait. Blind yourselves and be blind. They become drunk, but not with wine. They stagger, but not with strong drink. For the Lord has poured over you a spirit of deep sleep. He has shut your eyes to prophets, and he has covered your heads to seers. The entire vision will be to you like the words of a sealed book, which when you give it to the one who is literate, saying, please read this, you will say, I can't, for it is sealed. Then the book will be given to the one who is literate, saying, please read this, and he will say, I cannot read. Then the Lord said, because this book will draw near with their words and honor me with their lip service, they will remove their hearts far from me, and their reverence for me consists of tradition learned by me, learned by books. Therefore, behold, I will once again deal marvelously with these people, wondrously marvelous, and the wisdom of their wise men will perish, and the discernment of their discerning men will be concealed. Now this passage has at some point God addressing Israel and at some point addressing the enemies. So we will teach through this and see what he's saying. But first, God dealing with the enemy within. The enemy within, verse 1 through 4. Now, one of the contexts we need to understand is that Isaiah describes Jerusalem's theological position as one based on this statement. This is the feeling of the people. We are safe because this is God's city where the feast days are held. We are safe because this is God's city where the temple is and where God is worshipped. So that was their feeling. And you know, even today, we have various reasons why we consider whatever we think is a place of safety safe. For some of us, it's just now. We are safe when you live in neighborhoods where there are people like you. Either in your religion or ethnic group, then you are safe. or when you live where people know you, you are safe. Israel, especially Jerusalem at that time, felt, as we say in Nigeria, nothing to you. Why? Because this is where the temple was. This is where God is worshipped. So nothing to you. Jerusalem is safe. This is what they saw. And that was why they used this term, Ariel. Ariel means Lion of God. And in this passage, it's referring to Jerusalem, the city where David dwelt or camped. This is the only place where Isaiah used the name Ariel for Jerusalem. That name actually appears only one time in the Old Testament for a priest, in the book of Ezra. It actually means Lion of God. That's a literal translation. So when they said, this is Ariel, Jerusalem is Ariel, they said, this is the Lion of God. And you know the characteristics of the lion, isn't it? Royal, strong, all the things you can think of that are positive about a lion, Jerusalem saw it for themselves. One other term for it is an altar for burning. A hearth, what we say in Hausa, mubu, where you put fire and put your pot. But we'll come to that. It's a very similar word. But in these verses and in this context, Israel called Jerusalem the Lion of God. And when God was sending this prophecy, this woe, through Isaiah, he called them with that name. But this time, it was sarcastic. You call yourself a lion. Lion. They thought very highly of themselves. That was how they saw themselves. Royal, strong, powerful, nothing can shake you. But we'll see what God means when he calls them lion. Because that's not what it was. So for them, it was actually a lion. Pride. Correcting. And one of the key applications we must reflect on at this moment is that spiritual blindness is caused by pride. They were right in that the city of David was unique. But the problem was that they were living in the past. They were living in the past. And when we talk about pride, one of the questions that strikes me at this time is, what are you proud of in your family? What am I proud of in myself? A person in church, what are we proud of as a church? Be careful, because when does it become a thing of pride? Because that was the beginning for Israel. They called themselves the lion, and they failed to see what was happening in reality. Jerusalem rested on the spiritual heritage instead of the present reality. The reality was very far from royalty, from honesty, from kingship, from ruling. Very, very far from that, as we saw in all the previous chapters, and as we see in the remaining chapters. What God saw when he looked was very far from what the people saw. Jerusalem was living at that time for their present pleasures. They had no concern for God. Look at that phrase. Add year to year, observe your feasts on schedule. If you remember back in chapter 1, there was a description of what was happening in Jerusalem, and God said, look, I am fed up with you people. But if you notice, all of the things that characterize the grace and holy worship were taking place there. All the feasts were taking place regularly. In fact, multitudes were there. That's what God said. Look, what is all this multitude in my courts? This trampling of my courts. Who asked for it? Two, they were doing all the sacrifices. All that was described in the Old Testament, they were sacrificing. I remember someone cracking a joke that, nowadays we become more serious with sin if we were operating under those sacrifices, you know? If you had certain, you had other goats or sheep and you went out with them, and for each sin you did, you have to sacrifice one of them. Your wife will see you go out with like 10 sheep. When you come back, you have like 2. You say, what happened? You say, I had a bad day. So Jerusalem was living for the present pleasures, but their eyes were on what was achieved in the past. And so God's punishment, as he dealt with this enemy within, as he looked at this pride, was there in verse 1 and 2. 2 says, I will bring distress to Aaron. So, no matter how high an opinion of yourself you have, you are never out of reach of the hand of judgment of God. And this is true all over. Instead of a routine year to year and feast upon feast, God said he's going to send heaviness, lamenting, mourning, and sorrow. And it's interesting that he now said, you call yourself Ariel, you will become Ariel to me. And he was referring to that definition of lion. I read about the Maasai in Kenya, how, you know, if a young man wants to marry, one of the things he needs to do is go out and hunt a lion. And when we say hunt a lion, it's not with guns. You go on foot, you use whatever weapons you have, and they believe in fairness, so you don't poison it, you don't trap it. You go out to the savannah and hunt a lion, and then you're qualified to marry. So I don't know this young man, whether indeed many will marry. And then the young women, I think they were all died before. But God was saying, the way you call yourself lion, you know the man attacks the lion with all fury if you are going to escape. If a lion attacked you and you are going to strike back, how would you do this? With all you had were your bare hands. You will use all that is within you, and that's what God was telling them. You have raised yourself so high, you call yourself a lion. I will attack you like a man will attack a lion. I will lay camps on you. I will come against you. He used the images of warfare for that day. And he promised that he was going to go into battle against Jerusalem. And then he will conquer her. Because he said, you will be brought low. Now, that is how God deals with the enemy within of pride. I'm as proud as a lion. God knows how to deal with this lion. He's going to bring her down. In fact, if you notice the term, he says, he uses this there, lofty self-image. We are very high up there. He says, you'll be so down in the ground, you're supposed to be coming up from the soil. That is how low I will bring you. Instead of loud voice, their speech will be whispering. You know, when somebody is feeling very strong, you hear the sound, the way they talk, but when they are put tight under a corner and they know they have no escape, their voice drops. And that's what God was saying to Jerusalem. And the second application I want us to draw from this is that spiritual blindness will bring us low. Jerusalem's problem was spiritual blindness. They didn't see themselves the way they ought to see. And they were proud. And they had a certain image of what Jerusalem was supposed to be. But God didn't share that vision. And I ask ourselves this question as we live in Nigeria today. What is the image we have of ourselves? Now, this is like the days of, you know, positive self-image. You know, Christians need to project that they are kings and queens and princes and princes. But is that in line with what God says for you, for myself? Because if it is not, anything else we raise beyond what God has said is nothing but pride. And in dealing with it, God has no apologies. He brings it down to the lowest level. Now notice that all of this is so that they will cry out. They will whisper. That is God's aim. God's aim is actually still to bring us to the source. And so, dealing with the enemy within, this enemy of spiritual blindness, God deals with it, deals with pride, by humbling us and making us seek Him, the only true God. Now, commonly, is the enemy outside that we like to see? If I were to ask us now, what is one prayer item in Nigeria, I can guarantee you that before we reach 5, we will pray about security, we will pray about human enhancement, we will pray about next level and the economic issues around next level. These are all important. very important. In Israel's time, we had pertinent external factors. And we'll see in verse 5 to 8 how God dealt with the external factors, the external enemy, the enemy without their time, and what are some lessons from it. So this enemy we have from verse 5 to 8, it's very clear that these are the multitude of enemies that have gathered around Jerusalem. Some were already coming around, some were already sending ministries, but it was clear that they had designs on Jerusalem that were not positive. They were not for good. And so the eyes of the inhabitants was on this external or enemies without. But God, in these three verses, almost casually dismisses the issue of those ones. This is not your problem. Look at verse 5. For the multitude of your enemies will become like fine dust, and the multitude of the ruthless ones like the chaff which blows away. It's not a problem. The external one that is so huge looming before their eyes was nothing, because God had it in hand to deal with it as you with chaff. If there's anything easy to deal with, it's chaff. Just, and that's it, it's gone. Find us. You come into your room, you see some find us, you take care of it, and it's gone. That's how we saw it. But that's what Jerusalem was obsessed with. The enemies we have, the multitudes, the ruthless ones. That was the description of the armies of Assyria and also Babylon. Now, when they came into a place, people knew that they have been there. Sennacherib, you know, all of them. It's very clear that they were ruthless tyrants. And Israel was on them. But God said they are nothing. God will humble Jerusalem in the dust, but will scatter their enemies like dust. And look at how he says it will happen. He says this will be instantly. It will happen instantly, suddenly. It doesn't take God any time to deal with the enemy without. The problem is the enemy within, which God will not deal with on his own. He wants us to want him to deal with it. And that always takes time. But the enemy without doesn't take time. It will happen instantly. In fact, when he says you will be punished, he's not talking about Israel at this time, not Jerusalem at this point. He's talking about these enemies from without. They will be punished. The nations that come against Jerusalem, God will allow them to come against the city and to humble it, but he will punish those nations that have come against us. He will deal with them, and in his dealing with them, the description of how he does it tells us very clearly that everyone will recognize this is God. Verse 6 says, from the Lord of hosts will be punished with thunder, an earthquake, a loud noise, with whirlwind and tempest, and flame of a consuming fire. Each time this is described, especially in the Old Testament, it is explained to us the power of God over all of nature. Something that makes you realize this one is not a human being that is doing it. So instantly, and with a clear manifestation of the power of God, this other nation will be dealt with. And if you remember, moving forward into captivity, the head of gold, what happened to it? It was in one night that the kingdom was taken from Nebuchadnezzar's son, Belshazzar. So it doesn't take long for God to deal with the enemy without. This enemy came with hunger, with thirst. They had a goal in coming to Jerusalem. That goal was not for Jerusalem's good, it was for their good. And he said, look, you go back unfulfilled. Just like someone who is drinking is eating. He didn't eat. You are attempting to come against my city, but you will not succeed. You go back unfulfilled. And all of those things were the promises of God for what was disturbing Israel at that time, which was the enemy without. But the enemy without is nothing. And so often for us in Nigeria today, and for many parts of the world, and for Christians everywhere, the question is, what is the enemy without that consumes you? If you were to write your prayers like Paul wrote his prayers to all those churches, what are you praying for? It's amazing how I look at Paul's prayers. For example, one of the prayers we read this morning in our scripture reading, his prayer to the church at Ephesus, that I pray that the eyes of your heart will be enlightened. The content of his prayers for each of those churches. The content of our prayers can be so gripped by all of these enemies without that doesn't take you on anything to deal with. Really, we need to be focusing on the enlightenment of the eyes of our hearts so that we are not proud, so that we benefit from God. And so God deals with the enemy with him, he deals with the enemy without. But he goes on in verses 9 through 14 to actually give more details about why he's judging Jerusalem. And I think it's important for us to look at some of the factors that lead us to fall foul of these enemies within, these spiritual blindness. Now, the ultimate reason for God's judgment on Jerusalem is found in verse 13. And the Lord said, because these people draw near with their words and honor me with their lip service, but they remove their hearts far from me, and their reverence for me consists of tradition learned by rote. And I compare this to what Jesus used this same verse when he was speaking in Matthew chapter 15, verse 8-9. And you know what group he was talking to? The Pharisees. The Pharisees. So we'll try and unpack a few lessons from these verses, from verse 9 to 14, on this spiritual blindness that meets the Pharisees what they were, that made Israel and Jerusalem what it was, and that if we are not careful today, it will stop us from benefiting from what God intends to do. This condition of spiritual blindness that is stated in verse 9 is a condition of what he calls spiritually blind and spiritually disoriented, because he talks about blindness and drunkenness. And he starts with saying, pause and wonder, my translation says, the delay and wait. It's kind of saying, look, Jerusalem's pride has made them blind and drunk. You are so proud that you are behaving like a blind person and a drunk person. He says, pause, think. You are doing it to yourself, but you lack the self-awareness to see the condition. I shared once about one of my uncles who used to drink. And one day, he told us, from today I'm not drinking again. And do you know what happened? He went out with some other cousins of mine, and he drank and drank and drank until... In fact, he was in a complete state. He somehow managed to find his way back to the house. The others went to another place to continue the party. So he came back, and it was in a voice caucus, and he was trying to get into the room. He couldn't. So he lay on the veranda there and fell asleep. And the veranda was such that if there's a heavy rain and flood, all the flood water would pass by that veranda the other side. So he came and coated him with a very good amount of mud and silt. And he threw up multiple times, he doesn't know how many times. He woke up in the morning and found himself in this mud, in this field, in this ancestral. This is the last time. And we thought he was joking, but it's true. For him, what worked was just looking at the seat he was in. It was just like, how can I be in this seat? Now Israel was so proud that they were blind and they could not see that seat. They could not see the seat they were in. They started not with intoxicating drink, it was a cause. And because they chose blindness and drunkenness, notice what the verse says. The next thing they got on top of it is a spirit of deep sleep. Now, when somebody is physically drunk, you want him to sleep. When he sleeps, he wakes up. Then it's okay, isn't it? But in this spiritual blindness that leads to spiritual drunkenness, sleep doesn't solve the problem. It only makes it worse. It deepens the insensitivity. And so the Lord will send blind, proud, drunk Jerusalem into the lethargy and vulnerability of spiritual sleep. How terrible it is. Know that when we are sick, we are doing nothing productive. When we are sick, we are vulnerable. When we are sick, we are insensitive. And God sent all of these things to blind, proud, drunk Jerusalem. And this is the danger of pride leading to spiritual blindness. In Romans chapter 13, verse 11, we are told, do this knowing the time, that it is already the hour for you to awaken from sleep. For now salvation is nearer to us than when we believed. And so as we reflect on this one, note that spiritual blindness leads to spiritual blindness. The word of God was neglected because the people wanted it that way. It was not by accident. I once talked with someone who was very high up in the World Health Organization about some of the outcomes we were getting in the health system in Nigeria. And he told me, look, when you see any outcome, it is because the system was designed to make it like that. So when you see things happening, don't assume it is by accident. It is because it has been designed to do that. And people may deny, but actually ultimately that's what they designed. If Jerusalem did not want prophets who spoke the word of God, they wanted silence. They wanted people who were not speaking the very words of God. And so that was what they got. In silencing the prophets and the seers, God simply gave them what they wanted. This has echoes with Amos chapter 8, verse 11 and 12, where it says, behold, days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land. Not a famine for bread or a thirst for water, but rather for hearing the words of the Lord. People will scatter from sea to sea and from the north even to the east. They will go to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. And you know, this is the terrible thing that happens with human beings. First, we do not want it because it doesn't say what we want. But then we claim that that is what we are looking for. We move from ministry to ministry, church to church. We want to hear the living words of God. Isn't it what we see? But when you read and God speaks to you, do you do it? No. Then he says you don't want it. And for Jerusalem, that was the issue. They have gone through years at that time of silencing the prophets who spoke the very words of God. And because of that, he concealed it. Look at how he did, how he dealt with Israel in this case. He said Jerusalem was going to suffer in concealment. And in verse 11, he said, the entire vision will be to you like the words of the sealed book. So there are two types of illiterates in this case. One were the true illiterates. Even if they give them the words, they won't know. They'll say, I can't read. But Jerusalem was also going to be filled with those who could read. But what is written there is concealed from them. And so in this deep state of sleep, it was impossible for them to hear, to read, to know what was God saying about Jerusalem. At that point, what were God's plans? What was he going to do? Because they didn't want it. And because of that, he sealed up those things. So spiritual blindness, as an application, leads to spiritual illiteracy. Normal illiteracy, you know, you can solve it by making the best illiterate. You teach it, but you don't have a lot of education, isn't it? But the problem with spiritual illiteracy is that, in fact, it's the opposite that can take place. The person who is literate, ordinarily, will become unable to read. Because even if he reads it, it doesn't mean anything to you. And so spiritual blindness is a terrible curse. What caused it in their case was hypocrisy. In verse 13, God was very clear to them. It's because they draw near with their words and honor me with their lip service. And so let's look at one, two, three things from this to learn some lessons about this spiritual blindness which has at its root hypocrisy. One way you know that there's a problem and there's spiritual blindness, the enemy within is doing, is when you have a heart mount and heart God guard. These people draw near with their words and honor me with their lip service, but they remove their hands far from me. What they say with their mouths is very different from what is in their hearts. Brothers and sisters, fundamentally, as we look at the enemy within for us, this is one of the key issues we must address. If we are going to have true intimacy with God, if we are going to relate with God in such a way that he passes on to us the secrets of the kingdom as it were and communicates to us what he wants us to do today, it must be men and women who do not have any heart-mouth gap. But the second was worse. Their heart was far from God. But have you noticed who created the gap? They have removed their hearts from me. These are the people that claim they are going after God. They are sacrificing, they are worshiping, they live in either the city of God, but they have removed their hearts from God. And that has created a significant gap. And because of that gap, blind, drunk, asleep, and anything that can happen, will happen to them. God doesn't move away from his people. They are the ones that choose to remove their hearts from him. And in this case, that also happened in Israel. So the heart mouth and heart God gap is one key issue that God had against these people that led to the judgment that was coming upon them. The second is found in verse 14. But the last part of verse 13 says their reverence for me consists of tradition lined by roots. The second issue is the absence of the true fear of God. The absence of the true fear of God. Their fear toward me is not by the commandment of men. There's a difference between someone who truly, genuinely knows and fears God and someone who is doing it because that is what men told him to do. And if we want to have that intimacy that avoids this spiritual blindness, there must be a true fear of God. Their hearts do not respond to God. Nobody responded to men. And you know what they see? He who fears men fears both men, and in the end is destroyed by God. He who fears God needs fear no man. These people do not genuinely fear God. They only feared men, and the traditions taught by men, that was what they feared. Not God himself. And the absence of the true fear of God is the second key issue. The third issue apparently in their case is the role of influencers, the wisdom of their wise men that God went after. That this wisdom of their wise men shall perish. And you know, many of us don't think we are wise men, but we are people of influence. If you are a young person and your friend comes to you and asks, what do you think about this? You are a wise man to that person. If you are in your home and you are leading children and giving them advice, you are a wise man to that person. We must be extremely careful on what direction the influence is leading people. In Jerusalem's case, you know what the wise men did? They are the ones that propagated that idea and taught Jerusalem that philosophy that as long as the temple of God is here, we are safe. You can do anything. You remember in chapter 28, those same wise men, those elders, said, we have a covenant with death. I shall not die but live. That's what they said. So the wise men promoted the very pride that led to all of these things. And so anyone in the position of influence needs to be extremely careful about what direction this influence is going, because this role of influencers can lead us to push up on the enemy within. And so in this short passage, we've seen how God dealt with the enemy within, the enemy without, and the reason for this judgment, that they have created a heart-mouth gap, a heart-God gap. Their leaders were influencing them negatively towards pride, and they were doing all of those things in the context of the presence of Yahweh, the God of Israel, his covenant, his temple that was there in the city. And so, in summary, we've seen that spiritual blindness is caused by pride. It will bring us low, because that's the only way God deals with spiritual pride, to bring you low. It leads to spiritual drunkenness, it leads to spiritual sleep, it leads to illiteracy. But it has hypocrisy at its root, the hypocrisy of saying, this is who I am. So while focusing on the enemy without, it is easy to fail to deal with the enemy within, which is spiritual blindness. And as we conclude today, I want to share with us what God intends for us. Acts 13:47 says, for this is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you bring salvation to the ends of the earth. I don't know if you've ever reflected on how much God desires to carry out his eternal plan in and through you. in and pruning. These plants are massive. It's beyond this small bread and butter things we ask. Yes, he has taught us to ask for them, our daily bread. But God wants his people, his church, for far bigger things than this. But to do that, it is not the enemy within. The gates of hell cannot prevail against God's plan. The only thing that stands in the way of that plan is our hearts. And whether they are genuinely and honestly in true worship to the only true God, so that he can use his people to demonstrate his power to this world. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your words. Thank you because you are concerned about our hearts, the condition of our hearts, and our intimacy with you. Nothing in all of creation can snatch us from your hand. Whatever external force we are seeing is nothing before you, it's like us. But Lord, you are concerned about our hearts. Teach us this day, Lord, to also be concerned about our hearts, that we will not be blind, drunk, and asleep. Please use us, Lord, to carry out your purposes in Jesus' name. Amen.